So we're being recorded as well, but unfortunately not for amplifying, so ignore the microphone. Thank you very much for coming. As we all know, it is 50th anniversary of the Cybermen from 1966, and Alexandra was on set at the beginning. However, you weren't working on Doctor Who originally when they came up with it, so who approached you? Was it the BBC or...?
I was on staff at the BBC, so I didn't get to choose what programmes I wanted to work on. I was told what I would be working on. So the manager of the department would come round to the offices and give us, and I'd tell us what we were going to be, you know, doing. I shared an office with Daphne Dare, who was a longtime designer on the show, and I used to hear her on the telephone and hear things from people from the Doctor Who office coming in and out, you know, and I used to think, thank goodness I don't work on that show. I would hate it. I'd much rather be doing dancers for the Val Dunican show or, you know, or a period drama or something like that, because if, as you were a designer at the BBC in those years, you did a whole sort of cross all sorts of things. You did period costume, you did light entertainment, kids shows, you did quiz programs, you did everything. So it was a really, really good training for anyone who was, you know, coming in on the job. Anyway, to cut a long story short, Rosemary Ross, who was the manager of the department, who was the one who organized the programming, came to me and said, well, she came into the office and she said, Daphne, I think you've been on Doctor Who long enough. And then she said, turned to me and she said, and Sandra, we've decided to put you on it. And I thought, oh my. And I said, oh yes, thinking, I don't like science fiction. I don't know anything about it. I know enough about this show that it's not something that I really want to be connected with. But that was just tough, you know? Anyway, little did I or anybody else know who worked on that show all those years ago what was going to happen in the future. So in typical science fiction mode, look where we are today. And isn't it lovely to see everybody gathering? And I've been to conventions and things in the UK and in Australia and even in New York I did one. And everybody, it's sort of like a big family, because everybody just loves it. Everybody wants to know as much as they can and get all that knowledge in their head so they can go off and talk together about, you know, I know this bit and he knows that bit and da da da. And it's just terrific. It's a real international family. So it's not just you sitting here in this room today. It's all across the world. And that's the nicest thing about it. So good old BBC.
Yes, good old BBC.
Although not everybody thought that for a while when Doctor Who came off and they all went boo hiss.
You were approached to work on The Tenth Planet. Unfortunately, I don't have large props, but this is one of your boys. The most probably iconic of them all, probably because they were quite... not only did the Cybermen fall apart, but they tended to fall down a fair bit on the show.
There were a lot of things about those costumes. And recently when I was in England and I met a whole lot of the men who are actors who've played in Doctor Who and have played Cybermen, and I go around constantly apologising. And when they did that thing for the 50th anniversary and that programme, the documentary style, you know, programme, and I was just telling some of the others today, I was sitting watching it on my own because I'd already been to see the movie. And I was watching it on my own, and there was this Cyberman sprawled in a chair, smoking a cigarette, saying, oh my, I'm so hot, I'm so hot. And I said to the screen, I'm sorry, it's all my fault. And I've repeated that time and time again over the last couple of years to anyone who's been unfortunate enough to climb into one of these or one of the ones that followed on from it. It's a great way to lose weight. Anyone who wants, any actor who wants to lose weight.
Wasn't this nicknamed the hairdryer, the actual headpiece on
That's
the
one I haven't heard.
Oh, okay.
No, but I think they were named a whole lot of things that weren't very polite.
No, it can't be repeated here.
They were all very good. They were the guys were terrific when they had to wear these. They were very pleasant, and safety pins and sticky tape were on hand, especially when we first started. With them in the, because we did pre-filming at Ealing Film Studios before we actually went into the studio to record the programs. So all that bit in the Tenth Planet where you see them presumably walking through the snow, mm-hmm. and all that stuff that's supposed to be snowflakes is in fact little bits of polystyrene. Very unhealthy, let me tell you. And in those days, the health and safety issue was not like it is today. So none of that would have happened if we were in the studio doing it today.
Because we do have this image here, quite iconic from filming of the Tenth Planet. That's yourself in the front.
That's me there. That's me. And that's Edwina, who was assistant floor manager. And she actually married Michael Craze later on and became Mrs. Craze.
That's yourself in on
the
left.
That's me there, yes. With hairpiece.
On the left.
Yes. So that was, I think, probably our first day working on the on
okay,
that.
So this was...
Yeah, it would have been, I think, the first day at Ealing Film Studios.
And the Cybermen themselves in this costume were actually more colourful than...
Oh, well...
They weren't silver.
No, they weren't. They weren't. The this is what I call the slimming suit. The outer layer was plastic. And the inner layer was kind of a knit fabric in a pale blue because we wanted it to be light colored. And so you had to think in terms of black and white and gray when you were working in these days because we didn't have color television at that stage. Yeah. So it was all tonal. And the tubes were spray painted in different colors and black to look like, they were sort of circuits or veins or something running up the body. These bits here around their arms, those circlets, were like a silver vinyl stuck onto foam rubber. And their boots were just little rubber boots, short ones, sprayed silver. This bit around the face was a jersey fabric. It was actually silk jersey and it was pale blue. Mm-hmm. And you can see in this reconstruction, this photograph was taken this year in England when I was at the Doctor Who Cyberman convention just outside London. And Cyberman 1 and Cyberman 2 are complete reconstructions by a man called Steve Allen, who's very clever, and he and his wife made these, referring to me in person and also by email. Mm. So they got it absolutely right, and I have to say they were spot on. Mm. So it was terrific to come across my two boys again. Remade, as it were.
So, Tenth Planet, of course, is also well known for another reason, being William Hartnell's final story. Mm-hmm. I believe you were on set to actually see the regeneration.
The changeover,
scene.
Yes.
So.
That was an interesting day, because it was the first time they did the regeneration thing. And there wasn't any of the digital stuff that we've got now. It was a case of mixing one camera into another. And there were very few of us on the floor of the studio. They cleared a lot of people away. And so Bill came in, and he knew that he was leaving, and it was really sad because everyone was sorry he was going. And of course, the poor man was ill, and he had to give up. Patrick was there too, and Patrick was very sensitive to Bill and Bill's sadness about leaving. So Bill came in and lay down on the floor, and then they had the camera, they photographed him, and then Patrick lay down in the same position, absolutely spot on. And interestingly enough, when you see it change, they're in real time and real faces, their eyes were very similar width apart, and their mouth and everything was very similar in shape to each other. So that when they mixed that, it worked really, really well.
Oh, wow.
And it was just a lady with a big machine where they mixed pictures, and she was, you know. If any of you have got the 10th Planet DVD, there's a whole thing about that.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
Yes, you will. You will know more about it than probably I do. Anyway, I was there, and again, I say, little did we know,
of course,
that it was the first time of many, many more.
Yes.
Yes.
Which brings us to the second one of your boys. This is a tomb one, unfortunately, but similar to the moon base. So you were involved with creating, redesigning.
Yeah, I started work on this, pardon me, and the costumes were being made this time by costumiers because we had more money to do this. these little sort of ball things were actually practice golf balls, which they no longer make like that. So they were plastic balls with holes in them. This was vacuum cleaner tubing here, and it was sprayed, you know. And then I took ill, and I had to go to hospital for an operation. So things were, you know, happening and being put together, but I spent a long time on the telephone saying, don't forget to do this, and can you phone so-and-so, blah, blah, blah. There was all that sort of stuff going on. And so other people came in and kindly took over my job while I was, you know, poorly sick. But then I did come back in time to see this tomb of the Cybermen and them coming out of their, coming out of their pod. And I have to tell you, it was one of the most incredible things I have ever seen.
Yeah,
and I will never forget it. I might remember that, I might forget the rest of the show, but I will always remember standing there. And of course they could only come out of those pods once,
yes,
because they had sort of like glad wrap over the front of the pod. And they knew that if they broke through that and something went wrong, they wouldn't have time to do it again.
One
it was
take.
A one take only.
Wow, okay.
But it was just amazing. It really was.
So you got to see that set in
Ealing. That was done at Ealing Film Studios, yes. Yes.
Fantastic.
Not in the TV studio.
So with actually creating this costume, though, it's quite infamous construction from what I hear with the sewing
was,
and
yes, because it was they were made of vinyl.
Yeah.
And it was a vinyl that had come on the market for actually upholstery making. And so it had a backing, a fused backing on it of a sort of knitted thing, fabric. And the people, the costumiers who were making these had a heck of a time getting it through the machines. And my name was Mud. But anyway, I didn't care because I was in hospital being operated on. Maybe that was my punishment.
You got to see the finished product.
Yes.
So.
Anyway, it was, as I say, we had more money and we were able to get a bit more fancy with it. But they still have the handles, mm-hmm, and they still do have the handles. And I have come up with a slogan that I think the Cybermen should have put on the side of their spacecraft. Like a sort of, you know, an advertisement for cybernetics, and it says, if you want to get ahead, get handles.
Excellent.
So that's what they say. If you want to be something special, you've got to have these.
So yeah. You were the person responsible for those handles?
I was responsible for that, yes. And all the other nastiness about it.
So when in the creation of, so it was Kit Pedler and Jerry Davis who came up with the idea of the Cybermen.
Yes.
When you designed the costume, did you liaise with them a lot?
I liaised with Kit Pedler, because Innes Lloyd, who was the producer, who was absolutely wonderful, he was a fabulous man, and he said to me, look, because I was kind of, you know, in no man's land of what am I going to do? And I read the script and I thought, oh, I can't do this, you know. And there's a meeting set for it where you've got to go along with some kind of idea and a drawing and whatnot. And I thought, well, I've got to do something. Mm. Anyway, Innes said to me, go and talk to Kit, have a conversation with him, because he's created this and he will tell you. So we did, we chatted, and he was terribly helpful. And he explained that whole idea of body parts being replaced, which now we take just for granted, you know. I mean, look at the Paralympics, for goodness sake. I don't know if you saw that woman in the opening of thing of the Paralympics, where she has cybernetic sort of legs and feet, and she's dancing in the middle of the whole thing. That was just incredible. And so back in the 1960s, of course, nobody knew about that. Mm. I think they might have known a bit about pacemakers, but that was about it. Anyway, cut a long story short, we had a chat, and so I had said to them, look, the script gives far too much information. I don't have the money to do all that, because the budget was tiny. They were putting the Cybermen in for the first time. Maybe they'd never, ever come back.
Yeah.
Ha ha. Because I remember when I finished the show and I was leaving it and I went, no more Cybermen ever again. Wonderful. Anyway, I had to cut right back and just do things like leaving the hands free. And that was about it. But I don't know if any of you have seen the redesign I've done recently in the last couple of years.
It was published in Doctor Who magazine.
It was in the Cybermen.
Cybermen annual
bookazine.
Which unfortunately I didn't bring.
Many people have seen that one?
It wasn't for sale as much here in news agencies, but you could order it online.
Yes. Well, it was here briefly.
If you found it.
Yeah, because the BBC have done, through the Doctor Who magazine, have done a whole series of books. They've done one on the TARDIS, they've done one on the Cybermen, and they've done about five or six now, I think. Anyway, the editor of that is a friend of mine, Marcus Hearn, and he asked me if I would do an interview and would I also do a drawing for them. And he said, what would you like to do? And I thought, he gave me a few ideas, and I thought, I'd like to redesign Cyberman number one using today's materials, and also going to the back to the original script and reading all the details that Kit put in about their seeing their hair and seeing this and that and the other. And so I redesigned it for that. And it uses... and let me tell you, it's a lot more comfortable to wear. and also it shows more of the human face. And it shows the hands, of course. And it does a few things that I thought were going to be different. But anyway, that's it. And it would be lovely to see it made up, maybe one day.
Maybe one day.
Yes. But it used things like Lycra and, you know, special effects on this. I made much smaller, this whole thing here. And there was, you could see the structure of the rib cage, and you could see the lung sort of underneath. And so when they actually would shoot somebody from one of these, my new version of this, there would be a whole lot of sort of blue pulsing light and things that would even come up through here, through the handles.
Yeah.
So it was as if the whole body was not just the gun itself that was firing, but it affected the whole body.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's it.
Fascinating.
Anyway.
So also, not only through your involvement with the Cybermen on Doctor Who, but you're also credited as creating the image of for Patrick Troughton's adventure, the hobo costume.
Oh, yes. Well, I call that committee dressing, because it was Sydney Newman, the drama head of drama, wanted to have a different feel for Doctor Who number two, but to take certain elements from Bill. And he came up with this thought that this doctor would be what he called a cosmic hobo. I'm sure you've read about that. And so I was asked to collect a whole lot of bits of costume out of the BBC wardrobe department. And we happened to have at the television centre a small lot of costumes kept there just as an emergency stuff for various shows. And so I picked out old trousers and old jackets and various bits and pieces, and we booked into a dressing room at the BBC, and there was Patrick and me and Innes Lloyd, the producer, and Sidney Newman stuck his head in and put in his two bobs worth. We tried on different things and came up with what Patrick turned out, you know, to be. All in second-hand, third-hand, fourth-hand clothes. There was nothing new that I can remember. So that was it. Cheap costume.
Because I believe that costume, because you were involved, and it detracts from today's thing, but in Power of the Daleks, now, there's been a lot of excitement about Power of the Daleks this week because they've been able to release it as an animated feature with the soundtrack. So,
right. Yes. Go on.
So your involvement with Patrick Troughton's costume,
yes,
was animated. So they're now going to actually see it.
Okay.
As they, because they lost all the footage.
Well, it was the same costume he wore right through the whole his whole time on the show.
So,
with, I think they had to replace the trousers at some stage because they had been patched to start with because they were pretty old, and I think eventually they just fell apart.
Mm.
So they had to find something else to do. That was another costume designer's job. When I first started on Doctor Who, I wasn't classified as a costume designer.
Yeah.
I was a wardrobe supervisor, a costume supervisor. And then things changed and we all got the correct name, you know. Mm-hmm. And but he did have to have extra things, like in the Highlanders he had to have, you know, bits of costume where he dressed up as an old lady.
Yeah.
And there were various bits and pieces that he had in different shows. Mm.
The Highlanders, which brings me to the colour photos,
yes,
which you apparently took.
They're my colour photos.
Your colour photos.
And I hate to say they're now on the internet with other people's names attached to them. I get very stroppy about that.
Yeah.
Yes.
So at the time, colour photos weren't very...
Yeah, nobody took colour photographs. And that was a day we had filming away from out of London.
Yep.
And I think it was my birthday, actually. And there was just Annika and Michael and Patrick and the director and me and a couple of the cameraman and a couple of other people. There were only maybe half a dozen, eight of us or something at the most. And so I had my camera with me and I took the photographs. And then I took a photograph also of the guy whose name I've just forgotten at the moment, who played the military, the English officer in his... Sorry?
No.
It doesn't matter. Anyway, he was the head of the English army thing. And so he had one of those wonderful uniforms that the British used to wear to battle. You know, white trousers and red coats, and then, of course, they all got covered in blood and all the rest of it. But that was... Yeah, colour photograph of him and the other ones too, yes. So they're the only colour photographs ever taken of Doctor Who at that stage.
And they were yours.
And they were mine.
And you've never been credited for
them. Oh, I have been. I have been early on. But since that, and there were photographs I took also of Deborah Watling when we were filming and on location. and I took a lot of photographs of her, and those have turned up on the internet too, with somebody else's little label attached to them. So. Anyway, there's no point in getting too upset about that. There's nothing I can do. I still have costume designs from Doctor Who, which I kept, but strictly speaking, they're really copyright, BBC copyright. Mm. So although they have been reprinted in many books and magazines and things, I even have the original Cybermen design.
Wow.
And somebody said to me once, wouldn't it be terrific if you could sell that on eBay and pay off your mortgage?
Well, I think you would pay off more than your mortgage.
I couldn't. Anyway, it's one of those things, you know. Can't be helped.
So now we've seen the Cybermen evolve.
Yes.
Several times.
Yes.
Mostly to accommodate the actor's comfort as well. Yeah. How do you feel seeing those key designs, the handlebars, the lamp unit, still being used even to this day, Nightmare in Silver?
Oh no, it's terrific. I mean, I've watched the development of my blokes right through all the different stages. and a couple of them I wasn't too keen on. I think it's number 4. Which is the soft suit.
The revenge.
The where David Banks is in that he's the cyber leader.
Oh, in Earthshock.
Is it? Yeah, I'm not sure. But they're the softer suits. And those silver suits came from the RAF, apparently.
The G suits.
Yes, and then they had all that stuff stitched onto them. And I thought they were terrific. I loved those. Mm. I thought the designer did a wonderful job there. And the current latest one I like, but I didn't like the one before that because they weren't scary.
The cyber industry.
Well, they had those silly flared pants and they were like something from Toy Town, you know. And I remember what? Oh dear. Well, I've said this in public many times, and I said I'm terribly sorry. My apologies to whoever designed them. But they didn't scare me, and they were clumpy, and you know. But the ones now, my word, they are incredible. And it would have been marvelous to go and see them being made. But they're no longer sort of like, you know, costume. They're hard stuff, you know. But then that all fits in with Star Wars and, you know, all that sort of thing. Stormtroopers.
So since moving out to Australia in the late
1968,
have you had any more involvement with the show?
With the show only when back in the 80s when David Banks tracked me down and he was writing the Cyberman book.
Which we have a copy of over here. Someone would like to bring the Cyberman book. Oh, here we go.
Yeah, this one.
This, there we go.
Which is not a soft cover, but it was hard cover. He tracked me down because I was working for the ABC, and he wrote to the ABC and said, have you heard of somebody called? And they said, funnily enough, she's working for us now. So he wrote to me, and he said he was writing this book, and would I like to be involved? Which I said, I would love to be. And, you know, a lot of years, decades had passed since all this, and I had to try and bring it all back because that part of my brain was in lockdown, you know, never expecting ever to have to think about it again. So, that was interesting. And then from then on, it became a sort of, it's got much more frequent in the last few years, so I go wherever I'm called, and love it. Yes.
So now, looking back on the program, and your involvement, how do you feel?
Oh, terrific! I mean, I just feel so privileged and so honoured, actually, to be a part of television history, only just a, I'm only a little tiny part, but I'm a part nevertheless, and the BBC was a wonderful, wonderful place to work in the 1960s, because it was full of new ideas, new young people coming in as writers, producers, directors, and many of them went on to become very famous. And it was carte blanche. You could sort of almost, you could do what you liked almost, until suddenly they realized how much it was costing them all. And this terrible, the budget, the B word, the awful B word, budget, came roaring up, you know, and has been alive and well ever since everywhere in film and television. So it was great, and it was the best training I could have had, yeah. Because I had never any intention of going into television, or it just happened as a, just happened.
Mm. You were more involved with theatre work.
No, I was involved with, well, yeah. I did fashion and textile design at college, and it was only a friend of mine who had been at college with me. I'd gone to London to see what I could do about getting some work of some kind, especially in fashion journalism. Mm. And I met him and he said, why don't you think about costume design? And I sort of said, what do you mean? And he said, well, it's what I'm doing now. I'm doing theatre design, so why don't you come along to college and talk to one of the lecturers, which I did. And while I was talking to him, and he said to me, he looked through my folio and he said, you know, I think you should really consider costume design. And I was kind of, and then the door opened of his office and these people came in and they were looking for costume makers to go and work at Chichester Festival Theatre, which was Laurence Olivier's theatre down in Sussex.
Wow.
And it was only just its second season. So I got a job there sewing costumes, and I worked for several big theatre companies for a year doing contract work, making costumes. And then the advertisement came up for people for the BBC, for designers. So I thought, oh, well, you know, in for a penny, in for a pound, I'll have a go. And I got a job. So, and I was 23 at the time. And when I look at the young people, because when I've, my last job in England was in the, from 2000 through to 2006 as in a managerial job. I was head of the costume department at a big opera house called Glyndebourne. And I used to go around British universities and colleges and talk to students of costume design in particular. And there were hundreds of them, and they were all thinking they're gonna be costume designers. And yeah. I had to say to them, hands up, how many of you want to be designers? And all these hands would go up, and I'd say, here's the bad news. Mm. There's only going to be a tiny, tiny proportion of all of you who are doing this course across, getting your BA, you know, in theater design, whatever, blah, blah, blah. There's only going to be a few of you are going to get that privilege. Think about what else in costume that you might do that will bring, put bread and butter on your table and pay the rent. And there are things like making, there are things like costume props, there are things like, well, there's a whole range of things connected with this painting costume, breaking down costumes, all that sort of stuff, all these careers that are attached to it, that people can do when they don't get the big tick, and it's often who you know.
Yes.
And I always look, when I see a program on television, I always try to catch who the costume designer is, and it's very rare that you get the same name coming up more than once or twice. And some of the people of my generation, their names still appear from time to time. And that's, you know, we're all ancient now. Yes.
Well, looking back now on it,
yes,
we're here
yes.
because of your design
well,
for the Cybermen.
Well, no, come on.
No, we.
No.
Yes, we are.
We're here because of Doctor Who. We're here because of the Daleks. The Daleks.
Daleks.
Yes.
We won't say the D word today.
No, we won't say the D word.
So,
at all.
We all love Cybermen.
Of course you do.
I love Cybermen.
They may not love us back, but
emotionless.
So they like to think.
Yeah.
All we can do, thank you so much. From myself, from the committee, and we have got some questions.
A lot of the costumes I designed for that show actually never made it to the screen. Never made it, full stop, were never made. And I looked at it the other day for the first time. I had the DVD for ages and I thought, I better have a look at this. And I thought, it got to be one of the worst Doctor Who shows ever made. It's appalling. The acting's all, the sets are abysmal. The costume, there are bits of, I should have put him in something. Oh, I should have done. Oh, dear. Did I want to leave this program? I think it did. but the fish people were fun because, again, that was in the days before Lycra. And so they had a kind of a jersey knit fabric base with big sequins sewn all over it. And they were in the pool in the studio at Ealing Film Studios, this big tank. And I hate to think how long the water had been in the tank. And it certainly wasn't heated. And these poor people were in there in these costumes. And then when they were helped out up onto the, you know, onto dry land, the water would all run out of it. It was like those 1920s swimming suits, you know, that people wore, that when they came out of the sea, the crutch was way down around their knees.
Yeah.
And so they stood there while the water all poured out of their costumes. But yeah, it's a pity it wasn't in color, because they really did look very nice in color. And those sequins were all iridescent. And so they were all different colors, you know. And it was good old pale blue again for the basic suit. And again, it was budget, you know, budget things. But yes, they look okay in the photographs, but the program was a disaster. I think.
Oh,
yes.
We love Doctor Who. All programs.
Well, yes, anyway.
And seeing we've got just behind you, actually. Sorry.
No, because I had a directive from the top that he had to have elements of the first Doctor, but he had to be tatty, if you know what I mean, and a bit scruffy.
Yeah.
So that's what it was.
Okay.
So I had to work on what I was told, and what everybody went. Oh yes, that's lovely. That'll do. You know.
Yeah.
Okay, we have a question.
I was just wondering more about the choreography of the Cybermen, if you had to design a costume to accommodate the iconic, well, I suppose the iconic Cybermen march, and if you had just found it easy to actually, you know, walk in those costumes.
In the early days, they weren't doing all that marching stuff. That came later, I think, when they had big, clumpy, you know, heavy things on, and that was to make people think, hear the noise before they saw the, you know, saw the character, and when you heard the stomping, you know your blood turned to ice. So to speak. Oh, but I don't remember. I can't remember any stomping going on, and my guys wore rubber boots, so they'd been hopeless for. And they were always telling us in the studio, oh, you've got to wear rubber soles, or you've got to have felt on the. We had to put felt on the. On the soles of the shoes that actors wore, so that it wouldn't make, and that's up until not all that long ago, because the sound people would go all peculiar about, I can hear the footfall, you know. So yeah, there was nothing like that in my day. Yeah, they just flopped around in rubber boots, really.
What was it like to work for with Patrick Troughtons for designing this costume?
lovely. He was such a nice man. He was an absolute sweetheart. Everybody loved him, and he was so... he was sensitive, and he was funny, and once he'd got his frock right, you know, he was fine. And that was the end of it for me. I just had to get order, like when we did the Highlanders and things like that, I had to order bits and pieces for him to wear, or had to find them, so that he could add those to his, or he could disguise himself or whatever. but he was lovely to work with, and a really nice man, yeah.
Mentioning about the rubber boots, and the gentleman there was mentioning about the clunking, you know, that we hear with all the noise and to a dramatic effect. But remember back many, many years ago, might have been before the rubber boots, but an episode we had the Cybermen running along the street and had a close up of their feet and these wonderful shoes with lace ups, and they were desert boots. I remember
they were army boots. Now that was, I had those for the second Cybermen. Well, their hands are, you see, hands. You need hands for shoelaces, you know, you need yes, heads for anything else. Anyway, no, I used army boots for the second ones, but they had rubber soles on too, and I sprayed them silver with car paint, and then they had black shoelaces.
It was just the close-up of the boots when they're running down the street, or wherever it was, that it didn't get deleted off. So I actually saw the nice little bows on these shoes.
At least it didn't have their name tag on it. That's happened. When the BBC used to do live drama, it wasn't pre-recorded. It was all done live from the studio. And there was a lovely story about when they were doing the series in black and white on Jesus of Nazareth. And there was a scene where... there's a story about this man being dead and Jesus brings him back to life, and the man was lying, he had his feet facing the camera, and on the bottom of the shoe was his name stuck on, the actor's name, you know, full on there. Because the boots had come from the costumiers, and they'd named everything, you know, so that when the costumes arrived, they'd know whose boots were what, or whose shoes or sandals they'd have been. Yeah, but...
that's one of the things I remember most, I think, about the Cybermen of the years, is those lace-up boots.
Yes. Yes. Okay, so I've been told one more question.
All right.
Time?
Yeah. Alexandra, you were speaking before about the tomb of the Cybermen. I quite agree with you. Bursting out of those pods, yeah. One of my most vivid memories, which was magnificent. Yeah. Now, the Cybermats appeared in that particular story, but I know you didn't design them.
No,
it was Michael John Harris.
That would have been props. BBC props would have, or some prop maker would have done those.
And if they didn't ask you to design them?
No, because it wouldn't have been. It wasn't in my contract,
yes,
to do those kind,
yes,
of things.
To do that kind of thing.
Because certain props that people, there are two types of props. There are hand props,
yes,
which people are going to carry, and quite are maybe like a pair of gloves or something, and that's would be up to me to provide those.
Yes.
But other props are done by a props department because they're a different thing altogether. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Okay. Well, that brings it to a close.
Okay.
Thank you so much. On behalf of everyone here at Doctor Who Club.
Oh my goodness.
Just to
I've got to go on the train.
I don't, we thought of that.
I've got a bag for you to carry them on.
Oh, beautiful. Oh, thank you so much.
My pleasure. And there's a few